Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming our guest of honour, the Honourable Hekia Parata.
Tēnā koutou. Ngā mihi nui ki a tātou e whakawhāti nei I runga I te whenua e manaaki nei I a te Aotearoa. Talofa lāwa lua manuwao Winnie Laban, huri no I tō tātou whare ngā mihi nui ki a tātou. Good morning and thank you for welcoming me here to my second Trans-Tasman breakfast. Last year I had the opportunity in my incarnation as Minister of Women's Affairs and Ethnic Affairs, but also I had the absolute privilege to be impersonating the Minister of Energy and Resources for 12 months last year as well, and was hosted by Trans-Tasman in Auckland. So I would just like to acknowledge you, Philip, and your organisation for providing such a very good forum at which we can discuss a range of these issues. I'd like to also acknowledge our Secretary of Education, Leslie Longstone, who is here with us this morning, together with, I think, a speaker you've also had recently, Gabrielle McLouf from the Treasury. And of course, I'm sure there are luminaries amongst you. Well, see, this is a problem when you start naming names, then you start to realise that you're getting yourself into trouble. But I see that Graham Stoop, also the head of our Education Review Office, which is doing a fabulous job in monitoring and identifying where great performance is occurring across the education sector, is also here this morning. But to each and every one of you, welcome, and thank you for joining us so early in the morning in this wonderful climate and of Wellington. I got in the lift this morning with a gentleman who's here with us, I think, who I announced it's 10 degrees in Wellington. He said, that's optimistic. and we'd both been in Napier over the weekend where, of course, it felt like it was sort of 25 degrees. Ridiculously hot, really. So I'm here today to talk about our education plan. Education is a subject that's dear to my heart and head, as I'm sure it is to yours as future employers and business associates of young New Zealanders who are coming through the system today. I've been around the education sector for many, many years, and I've been the Minister of Education for the last 5 months. And I'm passionate about education, as I am about most things, because what's the point of not being, and what a good education can do for young people. We have an education system that is amongst the best in the world. It gives our students a platform to compete here at home as well as internationally. 4 out of 5 of our kids are successful. They're getting qualifications that they need from school, and we must celebrate that success. And of course, the professionals in classrooms who deliver that day after day up and down the country. But our government's education plan is to get 5 out of 5. We want all our kids to be leaving school with the skills they need to reach their potential in the modern economy. That means lifting up those who are being left behind and encouraging those who are doing well to do even better. Too many of the kids falling behind because they are not getting the quality teaching or quality leadership that all the evidence tells us makes the difference are Māori and Pacifica learners, those who come from low socioeconomic homes or have special needs. We can and must do better for them. We don't have a generation to waste. New Zealand is a small country. We must make up for size with smarts. We must outthink our competitors. We must ensure that our investments in 21st century technologies are matched by new and skilled thinking that reflects the best teaching practices and our natural cultural advantages. Education can and does make a twofold contribution to our country. It builds our social and cultural strength while also contributing to growth and productivity. That's important for our economy and it's important for New Zealand. I'm here today to talk about raising achievement for all New Zealanders, realising the potential of all our learners, creating Kiwis that can fly. We want to ensure a world-leading education system that equips our kids with the knowledge, skills and values to be successful people in the 21st century. Today, I can confirm that Budget 2012 will increase overall spending on education for the fourth budget in a row. This has happened despite tight fiscal constraints against the backdrop of a recent global financial crisis and the Canterbury earthquakes. Notwithstanding this, our government will increase education for the fourth budget in a row. This is a track record that reflects the priority that our government places on our plan for education. Education is a winner in Budget 2012. We are ambitious to see all our children reach their potential, and that's why we aim to have 85% of 18-year-olds having achieved a minimum Level 2 qualification, NCEA 2 or equivalent, by 2016. This is a passport for a better life, because learning is earning. Reaching that target will be challenging, but it is possible. It requires more of what counts and perhaps less of what's comfortable, and it's vital that we get there. So we must ensure our money, your taxes, is being spent to realise the potential of each and every learner. If it's not raising the achievement of our kids in big or small ways, if we can't see progress in tiny steps or leaps and bounds, unless we can see positive growth, however we measure it, we should not be doing it. We need to give our learners the best possible education we can. That means making good decisions with the money we have. Right from the earliest years of a child's life, we know that the quality of early childhood education gets kids ready for learning at school. We want kids to go to primary school eager, confident, able to engage. That's why our plan for education has a target of 98% participation in early childhood education by 2016. We have increased spending on ECE by a third since 2008, and we now spend more than ever on this most important start to life. The 34% increase since 2008 is spending that complements and reinforces the positive parenting that goes on in the vast majority of homes up and down our country, as well as targeting the most vulnerable children. We are continuing to target areas of high need in early childhood education, and you'll see more of that in the budget. After early childhood, parents then send their most cherished creation, their young child, to school. We entrust schools with our children, and with the high expectations we have of and for them. The platform for learning is formally built in these critical primary years. All of us want to understand, at regular intervals, how well the building of that platform is progressing and strengthening. With the introduction of national standards by our government, data and information is being collected and reported to show if kids are doing well, how their learning is improving, and what needs to change for better learning. Parents tell me that they are pleased to have this information about how much their child's learning has progressed, as well as where their child's achievement sits in their classroom and nationwide. Ensuring that our Year 8 students arrive from primary school prepared and ready is essential for their success at senior school levels. Our plan for education includes clarifying tertiary and vocational pathways so students can consider early the best options for them. There is no point arriving at years 11, 12, and 13 and finding that they have a random bunch of credits that don't amount to a meaningful qualification. The challenge for our secondary schools is to retain all students, especially through those vulnerable years 9 to 10, and to ensure that they can secure a passport to a better quality of life. At present, 1 in 5 of all our 15 to 16-year-olds are dropping out without any qualification. But we want all 18-year-olds to have a minimum of NCEA 2 or equivalent. Why? Because learning is earning. We are also doing a lot to invest in 21st century learning environments. This includes setting aside the first $1 billion, yay, from the Future Investment Fund to create modern learning environments, and we are spending between $300 million and $400 million on the Network for Learning, which will ensure that our students can make the most of all the opportunities that are coming from the $1.5 billion investment that our government has made in ultra-fast broadband. The classroom your child learns in today is going to be quite different from the classrooms looking around and taking a quick age assessment that we all learnt in. And their learning spaces will continue to evolve and change. We're doing a lot to raise student achievement in schools, but there's more we can do. There are two main investments we can make to raise achievement. They are in quality teaching and quality professional leadership. I'd like to talk a bit about these now. Our biggest value investment is our education profession. The approximately 50,000 teachers, 2,500 principals, and 35,000 non-teaching support staff. These numbers have increased by nearly 6,000 teachers over the past 10 years, and to be honest, at the same time, our student achievement results have plateaued. We have $3.69 billion invested in teachers and principals' salaries. That's just under half of the education vote for that sector. The salary bill has increased by around 55%, well over inflation, since the year 2000, with only an incremental increase in achievement and not by all learners. Even so, our national-led government is committed to improving the quality of learning, the quality of teaching, through ongoing investment of just over $300 million over the next 4 years in professional learning and development. Today, I'm pleased to announce that in Budget 2012, we will invest a further $511.9 million, or $512 for ease of reference, Gabs, and maybe that extra $100,000, of new money into quality frontline education services. So, Budget 2012, we will be investing a further $511.9 million into quality frontline education services. Quality teaching, it's about holding high expectations of, being able to relate to, and finding what works for every single child in the classroom. That's what every one of our teachers needs to be able to do. As parents, we all know that our children have some things in common, but actually are distinctly different. You have to find what works for that kid in order to be a successful parent. And that's the same expectation we hold of our professionals. A good example that I was recently able to see is of Oturu School in the far north, where with great professional leadership and outstanding teaching, students and their whole school community have engaged in a fun cross-curriculum program. It has seen strengthened literacy and numeracy through a number of initiatives such as growing, harvesting, and marketing olive oil, as well as developing effective local remedies for skin and hair conditions. They tell me that they have eradicated eczema in their community. So what's this school doing? They're learning, earning, and having fun. Another good example is Amesbury School, here in Wellington, which I visited just last week. The students there are engaged through art, music, dance, multimedia activities, expressed equally naturally in beautiful English and Te Reo Māori and across all age groups. These are both examples of where professional leadership that is excellent and teaching is of the highest quality can engage kids across the curriculum, ensure that they become literate and numerate, but they're having fun at the same time. That's what quality teaching and leadership looks like. You can recognise it at 20 feet. We're embarking on a 2-year work program to retain and grow, 20 metres, let me just get myself into the 21st century we're trying to equip ourselves for. To assist in that regard, we are embarking on a 2-year work program to retain and grow, as well as attract the best talent into this profession. To do that, we will invest an additional $60 million over 4 years to boost new teacher recruitment and training. We will ensure that student teachers are equipped with the best teaching practices for 21st century learning. We will shift to a postgraduate qualification for new teachers, and we will give stronger mentoring and coaching for those teachers working towards full registration. We will develop better career progression pathways so that excellent teachers can choose to stay in the classroom. We will introduce a new pre-principalship qualification that will strengthen the recruitment and selection of school leaders. And we will review the Teachers Council to secure a stronger professional body. We are investing in better teaching. We need ways to recognise and reward our outstanding teachers, as well as work with those who have potential. We also need to identify those who are not keeping up or who are just going through the motions. To raise teaching quality, we have to identify who is delivering successful practice and make it common practice. To this end, we will collaborate in the development of an appraisal system focusing on driving up quality teaching and quality professional leadership. Performance pay is but one of a basket of options to reward and recognise that. Teaching is a profession. Professions have a number of characteristics, of which accountability for performance, good, great, outstanding, unacceptable, is one. The reality is that we are in a tight economic environment. In order to make this investment in quality teaching and leading, we have to make some trade-offs. As I've already outlined, we are opting for quality, not quantity, better teaching, not more teachers. We will fund the improvement in teaching quality by making a small change to teacher-student ratios. These changes will free up just over $43 million on average in each year over the next 4 years. We will continue to emphasise the most critical transition years of new entrants and senior secondary school. The way we will do this is by maintaining or lowering the ratios at year 1 and years 11 to 13, and making a small adjustment to achieve consistency of teacher-student ratios in the mid-years of schooling. Ratios will remain as they are for new entrants year 1 at 1 teacher to 15 students. And for students sitting NCEA in years 11 to 13, we will now standardise that to 1 teacher to 17.3. This is a funding formula, so I'm not expecting a third of a child to turn up, but I'll just explain that shortly. In the middle years, years 2 to 10, there's currently a wide range of ratios, ranging from 1 to 23 to 1 to 29. To give schools consistency and certainty about how they manage their resources, we will standardise this ratio at 1 to 27.5. What this means is that 90% of all our schools will either gain or have a net loss of less than 1 full-time teacher equivalent as a result of the combined effect of the ratio changes and projected role growth. These changes will take effect over the next 5 years. To be clear, as I indicated, these ratios are a funding formula. They are how we as the government fund schools. The actual number of children in a classroom is set by the school. Every year, a school's role changes because families move or make different education choices. And every year, schools reset class sizes according to those changes in their role. These more consistent ratios will be fairer and give schools greater certainty over their resourcing from year to year. My primary school teacher tells me that my class numbered 42. All of you will remember the size of classes you came through. The logic of class sizes driving the quality of education is that those of us who went through in large classes really should be rather hopeless, and those who went through in very small classes should be brilliant. I'm not going to look around the room because you've all got brilliant light bulbs above your heads. So the point is that class sizes do have an effect, but it is the quality of the teacher in the classroom that makes that difference. So we know that from all the evidence that the quality of teaching makes the difference to learning and achievement, not one or two extra students in the class. The money we free up from these small changes will be reinvested into improving teacher quality. It is the single most important thing we can do to raise student achievement. In our education plan, success in the compulsory primary and secondary sector means better leadership and better teaching. It means delivering measurable improvement in learning and reporting that to parents every 6 months at primary or intermediate schools. That's years 1 to 8. It means year 8 students transitioning to secondary school able to read and write and do mathematics at a year 9 level. It means year 9 and 10s participating and engaging, keeping them in school and readying them for NCEA years. And it means 85% of all 18-year-olds achieving NCEA 2 or an equivalent qualification by 2016. One of the National-led government's key priorities is to deliver better public services to New Zealanders within tight fiscal constraints. Raising educational achievement while ensuring value for money is central to this. We want to ensure a world-leading education system that equips all New Zealand students with the skills, knowledge, values to successfully live in the 21st century. We're completely focused on giving children and young people the opportunity to succeed from early childhood learning through schooling and into vocational and tertiary training and education. So, I am pleased Budget 2012 invests more in education than ever. Education is a priority for our government despite the tough economic environment we are in, and you will see more of our plan in the budget on May 24th. We know the single most important thing we can do to raise achievement is to improve teaching quality. So that's why we are investing in better teaching, not more teachers. Education is a passport to a better life. Learning is earning. That's why our education plan is focused on raising achievement for 5 out of 5 kids. We want all our learners to realise their potential. We want to create Kiwis that can fly. The actions we have taken to date and those we undertake in this term of government reflect our education plan to raise education achievement and deliver on building a bigger, brighter future for all New Zealanders. Kia ora tātou.